What's up, everybody? This is Carrick with ACG, and once again, it's my continuing mission to bring you reviews that aren't 2 minutes long or filled with sponsored bullcrap. And today, it's going to be time to deep dive into the passionate past of our gaming lives, a time when games were simpler, more destructive. So destructive, in fact, that one game comes to mind that actually allowed and made game modes around the simple moments of a crash and even let you control it in a slow-motion ballet of steel, all the while trying to achieve orbit by flying around tracks and cards that have, at the very best, a broken home relationship with traction. Yes, indeed, that was Burnout, and today we're going to be checking out Burnout's spiritual successor, Dangerous Driving. This will be out on PS4, Xbox, and on PC on the Epic Store April 9th. Let's see how it did, shall we? As always, if you like the video, maybe subscribe. So here's my review for Dangerous Driving, the return of rubber band AI, arresting people via vehicular homicide, and the dangers of always making sure your traction control button is off. Graphics are up first. Now, one thing to remember is that taking into account this game is somewhat of a budget title. While budget for many may be in the $10 range or $15 or $20, this one is a bit more expensive, but it's always best to keep that in mind as we discuss. There are some selling points here in this game, like smashing through the sound barrier in a hopped up supercar and bumping one of your competition into oncoming traffic, or hitting some perfectly lined up turns and then slicing through a straightaway with ease, like a four-wheeled parkour moment. That sense of speed, something that Dangerous Driving is aiming for from the get-go, is actually handled really well here, especially once your meter is filled and your turbo becomes available and you're practically doubling the speed of everyone involved when you use it. Those are the good times, because when it all breaks down, the sense of speed in a racing game is probably one of the most important elements, and Dangerous Driving gets that absolutely right. When you hit the turbo button around you, the world starts to smear back, like time itself is dilating, and you're blasting into the past so fast, you expect to see the other drivers suddenly scooting around in friggin' Flintstone cars. And those moments are increased by a nice particle system effect, as well as easy-to-notice reflections in the water that are in most places actually accurate, and it does a good job to flesh out the overall image as you're racing around. Again, taking into account this is a budget title. Unfortunately, even taking that into account, there are some issues here. Of the 25 plus car models for the player to choose from, as well as the generic traffic that meanders helplessly around the levels just waiting for a series of head-on collisions, the likes of which probably only happen when you mix sudden snowstorms and lead-footed daily drivers, none of those cars actually look that good. Most actually have a distinctly mobile game feeling to their level of detail, and even the slickest of the later cars, with high-speed one-seaters being close to the pinnacle here, they always show an ugly side to them at some point while you race. It's sadly very spotty overall when it comes to presentation, even for a budget title with texture pop-in and detail swaps consistently. And in many places, it makes you wonder if you suddenly aged 50 years and your eyes went bad, and then pop, the detail textures shoot back into the game. If the frequency of that loss of focus was a little less often, it would be a slight issue and detail to be discussed. Unfortunately, this is more of a missed opportunity because it does actually happen quite a bit. Also, when I said detailed textures pop in, I didn't want to fool you because they really aren't that detailed in the first place. And that's that teeter-totter of presentation we see in this game, where sometimes it looks almost current-gen, and then other times it looks like a generation or two in the past. Let's discuss the crashes and the graphics for a second in those. This really could have been the highlight of the game. I mean, it's made from the skeletons of a team that created titles whose sole purpose was to see how far you could fling a car into other cars and keep it from falling to the ground. Instead, they're relegated to this strangely ignored moment where the entire game cuts to show the wreck, then does it again to get you back into the car with no camera sweeps like most other games that show wrecks, for example, Burnout 3. This ends up making everything incredibly choppy feeling when you're racing. Chop to crash, chop away back to car, chop to your crash, chop back to you starting again. The lack of a nice transition between them completely ruins the feel and flow of some of the races. Also, due to this and the lack of information imparted to the gamer during the expected camera sweep that would indicate where you are and what dangers may lay ahead as the game jumps back to light speed is actually missing here, resulting in a weird situation where when the camera cuts to your car, you can be in a totally different area than you sort of expected. In fact, I don't think a single time when my car was in the camera shot of another car wrecking did it actually end up being where I thought it would be when it returned me to the driver's seat, and many times almost magically had me already around a turn or corner or much farther than the speed would have indicated. Is it terrible? No, but I think when you're going to see with this game, it was one more missed opportunity in many. Let's talk about the locations and the tracks for a second. I'd be lying if I didn't say that some of them are indeed really interesting racing locations. You race through canyons or across snowy mountains, and that can look cool at times. And while you don't interact with any of it, including the puddles on the road or otherwise, there are moments of brilliance when speed and vision meld and you feel like a man on a rocket toboggan just jetting across the earth. However, none of the tracks actually really grabbed me. A couple of split ways to traverse at times, but they're maybe 200 to 400 yards at most before you're slammed back down into one racing line again. There are moments of verticality with you climbing into or racing down the sides of mountains, but even that seems a little bit underused. To me, budget doesn't mean haphazard. We've seen this come together in titles like Grip and others, and make no mistake, the genre is actually filled with a good number of budget racers. It would have been nice to see dangerous driving elevate itself to many in that middle, or in this case, somewhat middle higher price range. But the more you play it, the more it never really seems to get there, especially when you consider the strengths that this has going for it. And that includes the damage models, which are not very good at all. This really surprises me. You never see cars and frames bend or do anything really other than just shatter apart. Instead, you get a couple items flipping off of the cars and some tires missing and what looks like two or at most three small stages of damage in the system. Luckily, because a lot of the racing that you will be doing is at such breakneck speed, you won't notice some of this, but if it cuts away to a wreck, you definitely will. Of course, none of this would matter if it didn't run lickety-split, so this comes to performance, and I spent most of my time with the PS4 and PS4 Pro versions, and the game actually runs at almost a steady 60 FPS throughout all of it, and on the base consoles, locked at 30 FPS. And this helps because you are going flat out in a car that feels like it's trying, for all intents and purposes, to be an Elon Musk rocket design contestant, and that can really help tremendously. And for the most part, it does hold to that. That is until you get into the tunnels. For some odd reason, every tunnel you drive into has a massive loading glitch or stutter as assets come in. This can freeze the game for as long as a quarter to a full second, and sometimes more than once in the same tunnel. And this is not just the PS4 versions. I assume it's loading in assets on the other side of the track, but regardless, it's there. It's noticeable and it's painful as hell, especially because the tunnels actually offer some excellent spaces for making up time and many of the game's most fun moments. As a package, I would say Dangerous Driving wears the badge of budget proudly, but it doesn't do it any justice. And in the end, you're left with a choppy presentation of the main strengths of the game that it's actually trying to sell you. Namely, crashing and being crashed into and watching million-dollar vehicles shred themselves into fiery lettuce for a chop yard taco. This becomes a momentary distraction rather than a desired action, and that's a bit unfortunate. Sound, music, and voice. And you know what, let's do sound first here. There really isn't much to say. Most of the cars have acceptable sounds, though I wouldn't call it necessarily deep or detailed, which does seem puzzling as there are very few cars overall, and it seems like this would be a place where sound effects would play an excellent role in eliciting a feeling of power and speed combined. This is reflected also in these strange emissions, like changing into one of the two camera views available, and the sound doesn't adjust at all between them. I just can't understand what's going on with the wrecks, though, in this game. What should be the highlight of the game are incredibly drab sounding with almost stock sounds for crashing and metal banging together. And it also seems to end far too soon, with many times cars still crashing but really no sounds playing at all. They just slide across the ground. Have you ever heard a car crash? It's like four dozen mountain lions fighting inside a bag made out of drums and cymbals that was sewn together using a nightmare. The one sound effect that they could have done well was to put all this together when it comes to the crashes, and unfortunately it's just not done. One positive, though, that I did take away from this is the wind rushing across the car and the throaty whipping sound as you go into turbo, and maybe the skidding sound of the tires. But overall, it was sort of disappointing. And that brings us to music. Aside from the one main track that plays at the main menu, there isn't any music at all to speak of. So, moving on. And of course, that brings us to voice. Also none. So, moving on. And that brings us to gameplay and a bit about the story. There is no story. Wanting story in an arcade racer is like wanting an extra wrapper around a candy bar. It doesn't make any friggin' sense. Here, you have a series of races that unlock other races so you can go on winning races to get to the final race that's actually just three races, one after the other. Win that main event and you can unlock the next car class. Boom, done, pretty simple. It's based across a number of car types like SUV, coupe, DD class, and others, and the races run the gamut from fairly normal racing, if of course you consider half a dozen other racers all making Kyle Busch look like a violence counselor, and you also have other races like Heat Wave or Road Rage. Road Rage, of course, basically involves you pinballing from enemy to enemy as you send each one of them into their digital deaths as you scream headlong into the black hole the next turn, looking for your next enemy. There's also Pursuit. This is a good one. This has you basically taking down a growing cabal of road racers, all having performed some nebulous, horrible crime in their past, and you arresting them. And here, arresting them takes the form of a Michael Bay film, basically sending them over a guardrail into the depths of a canyon somewhere, because of course that must be where all the other cops are hiding. All of these either unlock more events or unlock vehicles, and it's a tried and true system that really works, with most events having at least two ways to unlock, and each tier of vehicles ending with that major race that I said before, which melds the three races together, and it takes your points from each one, adds them together, and the top points earners get platinum, gold, silver, or bronze. Now, it wouldn't matter how all this other stuff came together if the game didn't control right, and for the most part, Dangerous Driving does, but I really have to question a couple of the ideas here. First, the control options are lean at best. You're probably going to unearth more options for control in a text-based adventure than this game. It's basically steering sensitivity, and that's it. And trust me, there will be times where you will be diving into that option, because while the game is more of a callback to the digital pad days of yore, it doesn't allow for the D-pad's use, and instead you're on the analog sticks, which wouldn't be a problem, but no matter what setting you have it on, you're always going to find that car or class that needs a good bit of adjustment, or four. Other times, though, and depending again on the car types, it's rock solid with a responsiveness that makes you question why those other times feel so haphazard. The only thing I could find is that the game needs to have a dead zone or a dead zone sensitivity slider to allow for a bit more leeway, or less in many cases, due to the more digital pad feel of the racing. At times, it almost felt like there was a force curve set into the controls. I was able to work around it mostly with some epic takedowns on moments where I was slipping between three cars, doing a power slide, and sending another racer into the guardrail. That was all a blast, but there was always that moment or those races that it felt just a little bit off. Sadly, if that was the only issue, we'd be in luck here, but Dangerous Driving has a ton of problems. First, it's only got two views, which seems like, hey, maybe it's not that big of a deal, but the problem is here, the bumper view, while working fine for the races, restricts your far distance view, while the third person camera works, but the viewpoint is set strangely low on the body of the car, making things like jumps and even just going up hills a head scratch as you keep trying to peer up over the top of the car. A couple more settings would have gone a long way. Countless are the times that you will be driving and never be able to really feel like you can find the right spot on the road. Also, the game's use of turbo instantly brings to light the major issue in this game as it is right now, the AI. It is artificial, but it is not intelligent. For example, the turbo basically is built up by crashing into foes, driving into oncoming traffic, and slipping sneaky sneak like a bandit between cars. However, when you're not using turbo, no one else in the race is either. And when you use it, they all use it instantly. And that's when the rubber banding creeps up into the gameplay. There is no system built in whatsoever for the other drivers to use or not use turbo. They just use it when you do, and they don't when you don't. It's easily the worst rubber banding kind of system I think I've seen in a game. You can see it at any time and see its display at any moment. Just don't smash the turbo and everybody drives completely sedate and slow, and you can win the race without ever having to hit it even once with zero fucks given, which works if you just want to unlock the cars because that's how you do so. However, that comes with the challenging caveat that the medals for most races don't mean anything right now. Even the worst racers can win these races without trying at all. And the game's stickiness in its driving model evaporates at the boosted speeds, but magnifies at the lower ones. So there's this weird return on investment. Now you may be thinking to yourself, you know what? I want to go fast, so I will. And that's great. Sounds like a plan. And you can do that. You can slip that finger onto the turbo button and gently caress it, and then boom, slam it down, and boom, everybody on the screen does it at exactly the same time as you. It really is not good game design, and the callback to days most of us would like to see is forgotten. Luckily, it's less used, or actually just less noticeable, on some race types, and in some of the later races, especially with the faster cars decked out with engines that end in drive and probably start with quantum, this isn't as noticeable, as everyone is going so fast that if you crash once or twice, you can pass a checkpoint and the game will inform you you are now 27 seconds behind them. And this really hurts the game. For example, I noticed that when you're really close up and there's a crash that occurs at the end of a short race, since the reset takes so long, and every car in the game, by the way, I have no reason why, but they all have a faster acceleration than you do, that it could mean the end of the race if I attempted to use turbo, since you'd be eating up more of the distance between myself and the end. But if I didn't, I had more time, and I could just creep up on them and smash them all, winning the race that should have really been jackrabbit fast, but here I was performing all kind of turtle strategies on. Now, there are a couple car types, like the tuned car type, that allows for you to add a little bit to your top speed every time you do something in the game. That does add a little bit of a faster return on investment there, but it didn't really pay off. So basically what this leaves you with is a bunch of other drivers holding you up saying, I'll wait to show you mine. If you wait to show me yours, it has to be the most disappointing game of Vehicular Doctor ever. Also, the game is not very long. Depending on whichever way you drive to get to the end, there's only 60 plus events, with some of them not really taking that much time. All this could be fixed with multiplayer, right? Yes, it could, but sadly, multiplayer isn't in the game either. Right now, it's single player only. It'd be added at a later time, they said. They promised within 1 month. To me, that's the nail in the coffin here, but replace the nail with them covering the coffin with cement, dropping it in the deepest part of the ocean, and then checking to see if someone's alive inside in 1 month. It's just really missing so much. And sure, leaderboards are here, but for whatever reason, overall, you can only see a couple of the racers in your time area, and you can't scroll up or down. Right now, without human involvement to remove the ugly-headed robot AI that tries to suck the fun out of every event by sticking to you with the tenacity of Gorilla Glue, you're stuck with a game that doesn't really do much to reward you, no matter what you do. Takedowns just don't look that good, cars don't sound that good, and with this kind of AI, the game absolutely does not play that well. And playing well with others is definitely a side of the fun factor, which we're going to talk about right now. Is it fun? If your bag is just posting higher and higher scores against the AI, then this loosely fits that bill. Also, if you're a fan of those arcade quick twitch racers and you haven't got your fill from other titles, this could also possibly be something you find enjoyable. For me, however, this started to wear thin later on. It just ended up harkening back to times that really reminded me of what I enjoyed about arcade racing games, including an excellent soundtrack, really good sounds, and just a fun overall series of tracks to race, which this one really didn't have. So as you guys know, I rate games on a buy, wait for sale, rent, or never touch it again rating scale, with rent being replaced by deep, deep sale on PC whenever that score is given. And that score is going to be given right now, deep, deep sale. It is one of those titles that I think that some people can get something out of it. It is at a budget price, so a deep, deep sale on this could be somewhere around maybe $5 or $7. Maybe you jump into it. As always, on the console, you could probably rent it. I think that might be something that you would enjoy. But when it comes down to it, this is really just an odd time to release a title like this into the genre with this much competition. It really hurts it, and without that online multiplayer, it dings it again, especially when the AI just really isn't that riveting. So anyway, that's it for me. I hope you guys liked the video. If you did, give it a thumbs up. Maybe check out my Reddit, Twitter, or Facebook. All the links are in the description. And of course, you can become a patron on the Patreon website, which helps me give you guys reviews that aren't 2 minutes long or filled with sponsored bullcrap. And also, I buy a copy of every single game that I get, even if I get a developer code. Peace out, and enjoy the rest of your week.